Why did I decide to audition for Bill? Well, first of all, when I got the audition through, I didn't know that it was to play Bill in Doctor Who. Because the way they advertise it, because, you know, obviously if they advertise that they're looking for a new companion in Doctor Who, then every agent in all of Sundry is going to send every single female or male or whoever actor they have up for it. So they advertise it as something called Mean Town, which is an anagram of Woman 10, which is the woman in the 10th series. And yeah, I mean, you know, when I heard that it was to play Bill in Doctor Who, I was like, ha, that's great. I'm never going to get that, am I? Brilliant. That'll just be a nice little day out for me. You know, I'll get to meet Andy Pryor, who's the casting director, and say hello. And just thought, you know, it'll be a nice way of kind of, you know, showing him that I might be good for potentially other things. But, you know, there's no way in a million years I ever thought I'd be sitting here talking about it, having filmed it. So, yeah, I mean, basically, I auditioned for it because I was like, imagine getting that. That would be incredible.
Can you remember the first time you saw a Bill cosplay, and how did you react to that?
The first Bill cosplay I saw was actually about 2 minutes after I was announced.
Wow.
Two minutes is actually, that's an exaggeration. But it was about 2 hours after I was announced.
Wow.
It was, a guy... I had some friends around to watch the launch, and then a few more friends joined after seeing the trailer, as was the introduction of Bill, and one of them was sort of looking on Facebook to see, you know, what people had said, what people's reactions were, and someone was like, oh my god, someone's already dressed up as you, and it was this guy, and he had a massive afro, and he somehow had Bill's jacket already.
Wow.
And I was like, where did you... I mean, I don't even have that. I was like, where did you get that from? That is creepy. It was great. I mean, he had the ripped jeans and he had some, like... I think he just conveniently had some green trainers, but it was brilliant. It's so... It's really nice that people can do that, and people want to dress up as Bill. I think her clothes are really cool, so, you know, it's really nice to see other people dressing up in them.
How difficult was it to keep that a secret that you were going to be the new companion of Doctor Who?
Oh my God, it was so hard. It's particularly with the getting them around, sort of, you know, with to get to watch the announcement, because I mean it was on in the middle of the football.
Yeah.
And I don't watch football, and most of my friends know that, and they were like, "Why are you inviting us around for like the half time of the football? This is weird. What is going on?" And I was like, "Well, just come round and bring Prosecco and don't ask me any questions." But I had to keep that to a few people. And obviously I told my mum.
Yeah.
I had to tell my mum. I mean, I don't think... My mum's the kind of person who would sniff out if I was trying to keep a secret from her. She'd be like, what's wrong? What's going on? In the first sort of 2 seconds of seeing me. And I'd be like, just can't. I'm not very good at keeping secrets from her. So I thought best to tell her.
Yeah, fair enough.
You know, yeah, I thought, yeah, well, why not? Yeah, let her know. She was pretty gobsmacked. Not that, you know, she doesn't have faith in me, but I mean, as I was gobsmacked too. It was quite an overwhelming phone call, that one with my mum. There was lots of tears and lots of kind of incoherent that kind of from both of us.
Fair enough.
I mean, it was so hard to keep it a secret. Lots of my friends were just like, I mean, where have you been? I haven't seen or heard from you for about 6 weeks. Like, what's going on? Are you ill? Like, what is this? And I was like, no. I was doing a play at the time. And I was like, no, I was just working, you know, just doing the same play that I've been doing for 9 months. It suddenly got significantly harder. So I'm having to concentrate much more on it.
Peter Capaldi actually came to see you in the set in that play.
He did, yes.
And of course, he then had the obligatory cast photo backstage, and
you had to
pretend.
Yeah,
not
we had to pretend
him.
That we didn't know each other, and we'd already filmed the trailer. No, we hadn't filmed the trailer, but we'd met each other in the audition, obviously,
right,
in the recall. And I knew I'd got the job, and he knew that I'd got the job. I'm waiting backstage to go on for Act Two. And someone's like, oh my God, Peter Capaldi's in the audience. And I'm like, ah! Like, and I was like, what do I do? You know, I'm on stage with these people who I've shared, you know, nearly 9 months of my life with on a day-to-day basis.
Yeah.
And I couldn't tell anyone. And so he came backstage afterwards, and we were all like, oh my God. And I was like, Just is he going to say something? Is he going to announce it here, or say, you know, is he allowed to say? Is that what he's here for? I just didn't have a clue what I was doing. So I did the second half of the show in a complete daze, just sort of wandering around, looking around, seeing if I could like spot him in the audience. I couldn't. But and then he came backstage, and one of my friends, when I was announced, he was like, "Oh, I remember you that day that Peter Capaldi came," and he was like, "You were really weird." And I was like, I thought I was handling it really well. But he was like, yeah, you just sort of stood at the edge. It was like, really rigid, like, hi, Kate, great. We were both like, he came up to me and he was like, congratulations. And I was like, thank you. That was it. And then we were like, okay, just go away. Just leave. Just run away now. But that was very strange.
Yeah, and you afterwards, when you're filming with him, did you bring that up and say to him, look, what was that?
I know, but he was like, I just tried to come in secret. He was like, I just sort of wanted to see you doing something, because I thought it would be really nice if I'd seen you do something before we started working together. But he was like, but I'd done, obviously, he's Doctor Who. So, you know, they go, oh my God, is Doctor Who's come to see the show? Can you have a picture of you with the cast? And, you know, for him, he just sort of wanted to slip in, see the show, be like, oh, that's nice, she's really good, fingers crossed, and then go, you know. But then they sort of dragged him backstage, and he's so polite, he couldn't say no. But he was, like, laden with shopping. It was like, I think he was buying his wife a birthday present or something, and he was just, like, really, like, awkwardly, like, trying to manoeuvre all of his shopping bags out of the way. And he said it was horrible for him as well, because he was, like, he didn't know what I told them or if I, you know, or anything like that, so... Yeah, we laughed about that quite a lot. Such a close relationship, you know, I mean, between Bill and the Doctor, but also, you know, as the two leads of the show, we were there the whole time, you know. And, yeah, I mean, he was very welcoming to me and very supportive and, you know, really, really friendly. And, I mean, most of the first episode it was just, you know, it's the two of us and Heather, played by Stephanie, who was in for... some bits of the episode, but most of it was just us kind of all day, every day. So yeah, we chatted and a lot and became quite close quite quickly. For me, I thought when I read the script that I had to read for the audition, I didn't feel like there was much that I had to do. You know, I read it and I was kind of like, I think I know this girl, you know, I think I kind of understood her. But then, you know, perhaps that is that we have some similarities and, you know, there's similar energy. We look pretty similar as well. That's a big thing, I think. But yeah, I think there's one line in episode one that when I'm looking out the window before... when I'm telling the doctor about not liking my face very much, looking out the window, thinking my face is all like, oh, I've never liked it. It's always doing expressions when I'm trying to be enigmatic. And I'd actually said something very similar to that in the audition.
Wow.
Peter had asked if I wanted to stand up to do one of the scenes. And I was like, oh, yeah, okay. I mean, you know, most TV auditions, I usually just sit still and try and not move my, you know, try and keep my face as still as possible. It likes to do its own thing, but, you know. So I'd said that. And then Stephen had obviously, like clocked onto that and then put that in the series.
That's fantastic.
Which is quite exciting. He does that quite a lot, actually. There's little snippets of conversation. You're reading your script and you're like, that looks really familiar. I swear I said that sometime. Yeah, but it's great. I think that's testament to him as a writer, though, as well. You know, he's so observant and he's so, you know, he kind of allows the character to be part of you and allows you to be part of the character, which is great. You kind of feel like, well, you know, I must be doing something right if they're, you know, they're writing stuff that I said in the audition into the actual script of episode one. Then, you know. It's pretty positive.
The first time you saw a Dalek.
Oh, yeah.
What was... Explain that story to us, if you could, because that was... And what was it like to meet this iconic British villain?
Oh, it was great. I loved it. I was like, oh, this is exciting, isn't it? You know, I went up and I was waving, and he waved back. And I was like, oh, okay, all right. I'll see what's going on here. This is nice. And I was saying, I was saying it to Stephanie, and I was like, oh, yeah, look, you know, you can, like, shake hands and that. And then, you know, he started shaking my hand, and I was like, this is really advanced for, like, a remote control sort of, you know, situation. And then obviously they take their head off and there's a guy inside. And I was like, what? I didn't know that. I thought they were operated like remotely, but there was a guy inside operating. I mean, maybe I should have known, but I didn't. And that was hilarious because I thought I was completely au fait with everything. And obviously I wasn't. I still find it pretty surreal, to be honest. You know, it's still, you know, even having filmed it, I think it's like a dream. I think I've said that a couple of times before, but I feel very much like it's just a really nice dream that I'm probably going to wake up from soon and be like, oh, that was a nice dream. But yeah, I mean, it's wonderful. It's still kind of, it's such a roller coaster. Yeah, I think that one of the joys of sort of filming so intensely in Cardiff is that we kind of just, you know, I just sort of was allowed to like immerse myself in it and just kind of get thrown in and not, you know, not think too much about all the external pressures and, you know, how many Twitter followers I had or what people were saying about my character or that kind of thing. So yeah, it was just nice to sort of get into that bubble and just film it and then come out and be like, oh wow, yeah, it's all of you guys, hi.
When you became the Mondasian Cyberman.
Yeah.
What was your reaction when you saw that written down? And do I have to put the suit on?
I really wanted to put the suit on, but they didn't let me.
What?
I was too small. I'm too short for it. It was played by a very nice man called Liam. He was lovely. He's much taller than me, though. He's like 6'3" or something. And they just didn't think it was scary enough if just me sort of, you know, walking around in a Cyberman costume. It's not as intimidating as it's supposed to be. And also they thought that afro and the helmet thing could be a nightmare. It would just take too long to film, I think, the getting it on and off the head. But yeah, no, so we went through it and we did a lot of the stuff. So I choreographed all the things that he would do. I sort of said, you know, this is how I'd do it. I'd sort of pick that up there and then showed him what to do. So it was very much kind of, we did it very much together, which was nice. But yeah, I mean, it's a mad storyline, isn't it?
It is.
Yeah, I mean, I was shocked. I didn't know anything about it beforehand. And then I read the script and I was like, what? I mean, I think it's an exciting story, you know, and I'm all for the drama. So it wasn't nice. There was nothing nice about it, was there? I mean, really, if we're being honest. But yeah, I mean, it was exciting and it was very unexpected. And, you know, it was a really clever way to link back to the genesis of the Cybermen, which is, yeah. I thought it was pretty impressive and also utterly heartbreaking. So yeah, after the initial shock, I was pretty excited by it. And I think, as a finale, you know, as a finale two episodes, I think that this is going to be a really good story. I like a bit of drama. I said that earlier, and I think it's really nice to be able to play some, you know, some high stakes situations. But I think we got to put a bit of lightheartedness in there as well. And I think, you know, the mixture between the two, again, like I was saying about Stephen's writing, is what creates a really rounded character. And for an actress, you know, so for myself, that was what was such a joy to play. You know, you get to have the funny moments, you get to have the silly questions, you know, you get to be challenging and upbeat and fun. But then you also get stuff that's really heartbreaking or, you know, where you're about to die or that kind of thing, which is, it's great fun to play, you know. And I think also adds to the lightheartedness, also adds to the poignance of the dramatic moments, so. Would I have traded off something more, less intense and dramatic for a longer tenure? And no, I think hit them hard and then get out. I like doing dramatic stuff, and I really enjoy that. I'd much rather have an epic one series than a happier two series, for example. I mean, I thought it was really nice, you know, that Bill got a sort of happy ending than, you know, remaining sort of inside a Cyberman. I thought, you know, going and travelling the universe with a girl that she'd, you know, had a bit of a soft spot for previously, I thought that was a really nice way of ending it. And it was quite, you know, made the series feel quite cyclical, and, you know, I thought it was quite nice. I didn't know I was going to be back for Christmas, actually. I thought that was sort of the end. And then they were like, oh, actually, do you want to be in the Christmas special? And I was like, well, yeah, do I want to be on TV on Christmas Day that I can watch with my whole family and then in one of the biggest shows in British television? Yes, please. I'll do that. And it's a lovely story as well. I think it's a great adventure. I think you guys are really going to like it. I hope you do. Anyway, I do. So, you know, take from that what you will. Would I do Big Finish? I don't know. What do you think? Yeah. You think I should? Well, then maybe. I mean, why not? I mean, I don't have anything against it. So, you know, if they'd have me, then sure. Any other Doctor Who companion I'd like to do those adventures with?
Yeah, such as like River Song
Matt,
or Captain Jack.
With Nardole. Yeah. I mean, if we're doing it, we could do a, you know, get the team back together. Get the band, exactly. Get a bit more Nardy.
Do you think Bill would get friendlier with the 13th Doctor than she would have done with the 12th Doctor, if you know what I mean?
Well, I mean, you know, I'm not going to say no. You know, I mean, she's, you know, she's just very, very nice to look at, is Jodie Whittaker. You know, I think, I mean, who knows? Well, I'll have to leave that up to your imagination. What do you think? Yeah, oh, you think she would have? Well, I mean, you know, as I said, she is easy on the eye.
Just avoid the fan fiction section of certain websites, that's all I'm saying.
Yeah. Was that any previous doctor that I would have, if I could have worked with another doctor?
Yeah.
I don't know. I think, well, I mean, all of them I think are amazing. Maybe Matt Smith, I think. I mean, I met Matt recently, and he's very fun and so much, so, you know, energetic that I think his doctor and Bill could have had quite a bouncy time together, to be honest. Not like that. You lot, calm down.
Do you find TV acting or theatre acting easier?
Easier? I don't think there's nothing easy about either of them, I would say. I'm still finding them both very challenging. I think there are different elements of being on TV and being on stage that are more challenging. For example, you know, on stage you have to remember all of your lines for the whole thing, and there's no room for error. Whereas on TV, you can sort of, you know, you can go, oh, so, you know, what's my line? You can go back and do it again. But then on TV, you know, you have to maintain the intensity and you have to maybe do it 25, 30 times. You know, a scene where you're, you know, that the scene where Bill's getting attacked by the zombies and, you know, or asphyxiating or that kind of thing. I had to do that, you know, 28 or 30 times in one morning. And obviously with theatre, you don't have that and you get to sort of build up the intensity throughout the play and then you perform it that once for the night and then, yeah, and then you sort of carry on your journey. But yeah, I don't think either of them are very easy. You know, one of the things about this, you know, our time at the moment is like incredible stuff is being made for TV and a lot of, you know, big Hollywood actors are coming and doing TV stuff. So, you know, if I could continue to do, you know, a bit of TV and then maybe do some films. I'm just about to do another play. You know, if I'm lucky enough to continue to sort of work across all mediums for the rest of my career, then I will be very happy. I think that typecasting is definitely a thing that happens. I don't know. I feel like if I get typecast as Bill, then that's probably not too bad because she is quite similar to me. So, you know, I mean, whilst I don't always want to play the same character, I feel like, I think with a show like Doctor Who as well, you get so much variety within all the episodes. You know, you get to, one episode you're on a different planet talking to emoji robots, and then the next you're in Victorian London wearing, you know, full sort of Victorian get-up. So I think within that you get a lot of room for people to see you, people who may typecast you to see you in different lights. And I think as we were saying earlier with the sort of the light and the dark that you get with a series like Doctor Who, I think it's quite hard to be typecast on the back of that. Well, that's what I'm hoping anyway. What was my favourite episode of season 10? I don't know. I always feel very pressured by the word favourite. Because I've got, you know, I mean, the favourite ones to film. One of my favourite ones to film was probably episode 8 because my costume was really comfy. You know, I mean, wearing a boiler suit and a jumper, sort of running around in boots, that was pretty cool. I like that. I did also, episode 8 was, I thought it was quite epic. And, you know, all the narration from Bill was quite an interesting thing. But then I also like the finale. I like both of those. You know, the scenes with Bill and Razor in the hospital, I think, are so heartbreaking once you realise that he's, you know, helping, he's basically making, he's the master and he's trying to turn her into a Cyberman. But I also loved episode 1 and all of them. Sorry, I can't do favourites. I feel like I've forgotten all of them when I do favourites, and then they were all my favourite. My favourite villain,
yeah,
of the series. Ooh, that's a good one. It wasn't the Cybermen. I didn't like them. They weren't very nice to me. What was my favourite villain? Probably the monks, actually. They were creepy, man. They were, with the long fingers and that, oh no, the face of the dead, rotting flesh. They scared me.
If you could reinterpret the Doctor, how would you do it?
Well, as in, if I was to play the Doctor?
Yeah.
How would I do it?
Mm-hmm.
Hopefully very well. I don't know. That's a challenging question. I think the Doctor is such an interesting character. He's so enigmatic, and I think there's so many facets of his character that you could pick up on. And yeah, I think it would depend on the storylines that I was given. And I really don't know. I think I'd have to give it a lot of thought, I think, if I was ever asked to play the Doctor, which would be quite surreal. But yeah, I think there's so much of his character. He can, you know, he can be quite moody, he can be quite diffident, but you know, he can also be very compassionate. And I think, you know, the sort of the dichotomy of that is what makes him such an interesting him, her, the Doctor, such an interesting character. So hopefully I'd be able to weave all of those things through my portrayal. I'd like to be part of any other franchise apart from Doctor Who, like Marvel Universe or something like that.
Spot on.
Why not? I think they're great. I mean, I think Star Wars is pretty sick. And also the new Star Trek is pretty great. Yeah, I mean, you know, I think it would depend on the character that I played. I'd love to do something in another franchise. I think that would be incredible, but it would have to be the right character to be able to sit well within that franchise to make something good of it, you know?